candles on this street. Baptize us with the fire of your Spirit, that we may be a light shining in the darkness, welcoming others as Christ has welcomed us. For he is our light and our salvation.
Amen.
Blessed be God.
Shall be lifted up.
And every mountain and hill will be humbled. The unhewn rock shall become.
grass withered, the flower fades.
But the word of our God will stand forever.
Get you up to a high mountain.
O Zion, herald of good tidings, lift up your voice for your strength.
O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings,
lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God.
See, the Lord God comes with might.
And his power rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him.
He will feed his flock like a shepherd.
He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom, and gently
downspouts.
There is something was roasting his blue Advent chasuble that had been a gift to him from his former congregation upon his departure. It was a masterpiece of craftsmanship, dark blue, with a desert sunrise artfully depicted on the portion that covered his chest. The problem was that the members of the Church of the Transfiguration in Palos Park here in Illinois did not take into consideration the fact that he was moving to Palm Springs, and a heavy winter's vestment might be just a little too warm for him in his new desert climate. So, as we watched plastic snowmen placed in blazing heat and a melting pasture, we noticed also that the high school was selling evergreens as a fundraiser and wondering how long they would last there. It was all a strange disjointedness as to what was being depicted by those relics of a winter wonderland being transposed against the reality of days that were in the mid-80s and nights that were blissfully cool. To be in a swimming pool on November 30th is one thing. To be in a swimming pool while the owner is stringing Christmas lights is quite another. Added to this was that the peace of being on vacation was being shattered by the news of a grand jury verdict and the rioting that followed. Outside, little icicles hung in the desert. On the television, there were scenes of anger and violence. Upon returning home, there was another grand jury verdict that even true conservatives like Dr. Charles Krauthammer called totally incomprehensible. When things like that happen, it seems as if the world is coming unglued. And so we need to hear again the words of the prophet Isaiah. Amid all our self-inflicted wounds, we need to hear a word of comfort. There really isn't much difference between Isaiah's audience and us. Israel's time of exile this time was indeed a time of suffering and sorrow. But on this occasion, it was self-inflicted. Babylon was the place they ended up being because they had gotten things very badly wrong. As Dr. Sam Wells, the former dean of the chapel at Duke University and now the rector of the famous for music St. Martin in the Field, said, when you've made a mess of things, when you've sinned big time, there's a lot of hurt. By hurt, I mean the impact of wrongdoing on hearts and minds and soul, and most of all, the heart of God. But besides hurt, there is also damage. Damage refers to the lasting practical effect of what you've broken. For Israel, their hurt was their estrangement from God. For us, it is our estrangement from each other that matters the most. A nation
that longed to be united is now more divided than ever. The red states are more red, the blue states are more blue. African Americans and police eye each other warily. And people are forced to take up sides between the two, as if some communities don't need law enforcement more than others, or as if all the police want to do is create problems. In the end, I can't help but think that we only wind up playing into each other's stereotypes. Into this mess, God comes to offer comfort, saying, yes, you've sinned. Yes, there have been major consequences. But I am here to help you clean up the mess you have made. We may look at the road ahead and become afraid. We are still a long way from where we want to be. Progress has been so darn slow, and there are times when we may come to believe that we have about as much a chance of living together as an icicle in the desert. God understands that the struggle has been long, but God, through the prophet Isaiah, is telling us that while we have made a mess of things and that we are hurt as much as those we have hurt, what is going to be done is not in our strength, but God's. God will flatten out what lies between where we are now and where God wants us to be. God will keep our feet moving in the direction that God wants us to go. And God will carry us over those parts of the journey we can't make on our own. The prophet Isaiah tells us that God, even in the midst of great turmoil, still offers us comfort, direction, and strength. But those qualities can only come when we begin to see each other the way Jesus sees us. Remember the old Sunday school hymn? Red and yellow, black and white, all are precious in His sight. Maybe if we saw the world through His eyes, it would be a vastly different place. You and I know people, know them well, who are threatened by others who are not like them. And they are all united by one thing: fear of the other, fear of the unknown. And in the case of the police officers who have been at the center of our attention, fear of what might happen if the situation gets out of hand. The reason people attack one another is fear. Fear of being arrested. Fear of being hurt, naked, and arrest. Jesus comes to free us from our fears. But I must confess to you, I am not sure how that is going to be done. I don't know how people are going to choose not to live in fear. But I think it may have something to do with repentance. Repentance that takes us away from our tendency to generalize, to say of one group or another, all of them are, you can complete the sentence any way you like, All of them are thieves. All of them are out to get me, one way or the other. All of them are out for every nickel they can make. All of them are shrewd. All of them are dumb. All of them are sissies. Pick your group, pick your generation, and you will be able to find the root cause of fear. The antidote, though, is not reaction, but repentance. To see every person as not better, nor worse than you. I couldn't help but think of this once again on Friday when I did what I do so often, stood in the graveyard. The family of the man for whom I was conducting the funeral had been difficult. Not feisty or uncooperative, just difficult. We get the pallbearers all lined up, and one would disappear. The brother of the deceased was not only a wanderer, but a talker. There was no filter between what was going on in his head and what was coming out of his mouth. The deceased had been serving in Vietnam, and so military honors were called for. The honor guard was there. One of them, I knew from other funerals, a large, tall, army-muscled fellow, friendly, though, beyond measure. I did the committal rite, and he and his colleague came forward for the playing of taps and the folding of the flag. Then it was time to present the flag to the family. They are supposed to remain seated, but instead they stood. He asked them to sit down, and they did. Now, he could have done what he had to do standing up, but he was military, and the military has its protocols. So he had them sit down. And then he did what all members of the armed forces do when presenting the flag to the next of kin. He knelt before them and thanked them by name for their loved one's service to the country. I couldn't help but get over to the fact that he was an African American, a black man who loved his country enough to join the army and serve it, and then rise through the ranks. He was a part of that group of people who lived their lives in service of the country, protecting us all. And there he was, on one knee, not because he had to be, but because he wanted to be. Maybe when we come before each other, strong or weak, rich or poor, black or white, gay or straight, and are willing to kneel in humble service, we will see again the beginning of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's hope that we don't have to wait for real icicles to form in the desert for us to see them. Let's hope that the gospel of Jesus Christ can begin again in our day. And let's hope that that day will come soon. Thanks for listening. Thank you. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.